In a previous lecture, we talked about paragraphs in a general sense, an overall sense, and we used this website that you see on the screen here, and we talked about the first part of this.
This is take three of the continuation of take two, that is the continuation of take two, whatever that means. This is part one of a two-part discussion about how to write a research paper. So let's just pick it up. I think I know where I am. Hello again, fellow writers. This is Professor Phil Benoit in another video discussion designed to make you a better writer. Go over your work carefully again and again. As you do, you will begin to feel more like a reader than a writer who needs to get this project behind you.
Hello, I'm Phil Benoit. The clips you've just seen are from several different video lectures that I've produced and used in my courses at Millersville University over the past 3 or 4 years. In this brief video, I hope to give you a look at where my experimentation with video lectures has led me and how I script, produce, and edit the videos that I developed over several years, and particularly during the fall semester 2014 for my online course in advanced composition at Millersville. My first efforts with using video for instruction were done using a software product called ScreenFlow. ScreenFlow uses a screen capture capability with VoiceOver. I made about 20 lectures on topics ranging from clear writing to paragraph structure to the verb tenses of lie and lay. I had also seen and used in my courses from time to time examples of instructional videos about writing that I found on YouTube that included an on-camera instructor and on-screen titles to present information on the screen next to the instructor's talking head. I liked the effect and decided to experiment with that technique using the video recording capability of my Canon 60D DSLR camera to record the lectures and iMovie software to edit the clips together and add titles and other effects. I spent a lot of the winter break between semesters a few years back to record and edit my first full-fledged effort. Here are some brief clips from that production that will give you an idea of how I tried to present the information using some of the tools that I hoped would give the information greater impact using higher production values.
The New York Times lands on my front doorstep every morning at about 4 a.m. And about that time, I go out and pick it up and bring it in, and I spend a couple of hours at least with the New York Times finding out what's inside it. It's an important part of my day. I find it very important to understand what's going on in the world as reported on a day-to-day basis by the reporters, journalists, editors, and publishers of the New York Times. Why is that? It could be partly that, but I hope not, and I don't really think it is. Scholars tell us that we as human beings have an innate need to know what we cannot directly observe. We need to know what's going on in the North African country of Mali and Syria.
When I got the opportunity to teach advanced composition in the fall of 2014, I decided that rather than continue using a mishmash of the ScreenFlow lectures that I distributed throughout the course in other years, I would start fresh with something more ambitious. Picking up on that idea of an on-camera instructor with titles to reinforce the information, I decided to produce 2 8-to-10-minute video lectures each week for the entire semester. I coordinated each lecture with assignments from the textbook I used, Everything's an Argument by Lunsford, Ruskowitz, and Walters. As I produced the videos, ultimately totaling 28 8-to-10-minute lectures, I posted them on Vimeo, from whence I could embed them into the D2L courseware and incorporate them into my weekly units of instruction, using 2 per week. Usually the weekly lectures were on a single topic related to a corresponding assignment in the textbook and presenting information needed to complete the week's writing assignments. Often part one was about defining the principles of, say, writing a literacy narrative, and part two focused on how to incorporate the principles in the first lecture and in the textbook into the process of actually writing the paper. I got to the point where I could research and write the script, record the video, and complete the editing for one video in about 6 hours' time. The videos were often about specific types of writing. They might focus on how to write a causal argument or a rhetorical analysis, for example. Other lectures were on topics like the use of anecdote in writing or techniques and sources of research for academic papers and how to integrate research into your writing. It was my hope that by devoting the considerable time and effort to doing this during one semester, I could form a library of video lectures that I could use every time I taught the course. In the next segment of this video, I hope to show you how a production like this comes together and the equipment and setup that I use to produce one. Hello, writers. This is Professor Phil Benoit here with you again with another video discussion designed to help you become a better writer. The first step in putting together the video lecture is to write the script. I consult a number of sources for the information and content that I'll include in the script, and then I write it out word for word the way I will read it on camera. Once I've completed writing the script and editing it, I save it to the cloud. It has to be in the cloud so I can access it from my iPad. Once in my iPad, I select the Pages app and bring the document up. I select it, copy it, and then go to my teleprompter app called ProPrompter. Once in there, I can go to the edit function and simply paste the text into the teleprompter. I can edit out anything I don't need in there. And once I have it into the iPad, I mount the iPad onto the teleprompter device, which is in front of the camera. With the iPad in place, mounted on my prompting device, and my mic clipped on, I start the camera recording from a utility on my computer. I can control the teleprompting device from my iPhone, and I get a countdown. Hello, writers. This is Professor Phil Benoit here with you again with another video discussion designed to help you become a better writer. This is part two of our discussion about academic research projects. In part one, we talked about some overall considerations and tips about how to begin your research when tasked with writing an academic research paper. Hello, writers. Once the video is recorded, editing begins. I use iMovie software. Once the clips you need are dragged into the project window, titles can be added and other adjustments like sound effects and freeze frames can be introduced. With a little finagling with the iMovie software and appropriate framing of the camera shot, I was able to make titles appear in the frame next to my head to reinforce the points I was making verbally. The narrative has the following characteristics. Number one, it's a story. It has a beginning, a middle, and an end. It has a narrator, someone who tells the story. There are characters, the people who have things happen to them in the story. And most importantly, there is always a point. There is also a neat little process that allows you to convert a text document to a JPEG. And that can be imported into the project and edited into the final product. Here is how the writer used her sources to support her claims about monitoring employees' online behaviors. Monitoring online
when the JPEG of the text is dragged into the project, it supersedes the video of me speaking, but not the audio. The text scrolls at a speed that depends on how long the text remains on the screen. Concerned parent who is prohibited
from checking. What I hope to have shown in this video is that it is possible to create video lectures for use in online courses that have better production values than simply looking into the camera on the computer screen. I'm not suggesting that everyone who teaches online go out and invest several thousand dollars in the necessary video gear to make their videos look professionally produced. What I do want to suggest is that the homegrown video used in online teaching need not sacrifice quality for convenience. It seems feasible to me that for a very reasonable outlay of money, an academic department, a school, and a university, or an IT department could invest in the equipment necessary to put together high-quality video and make it available for faculty who want to use it. Training and shooting and editing would not be difficult, and a staff member could even be assigned to provide advice and assistance. Video is not the only or even the key component in a scenario for effective online instruction. But it seems to me that it can improve the effectiveness of the overall product when online instructors take the time to create videos with strong production values.
This is Professor Phil Benoit. Professor Phil Benoit, thanks for watching. Thanks for watching.
My lips just ache to have you touch.